Video games. We love them, we hate them, and we buy them when they come out every year. 2019 had some pretty good games, but vision is always 2020. So let's look at the games coming out in 2020. Flawless transition, I know. By the way, not only are these just my opinions, but also I don't have things like a PS4 and a really good gaming PC, so I'm not going to be able to play games like the Final Fantasy VII Remake, as much as I would like to. Plus, being honest here, 2020 is looking a bit lackluster in regards to its amount of games. However, they generally announce games that get released within the year later on, so that's going to happen inevitably. With that out of the way, let's get on to the games. Over the past few years, tons of different Mega Man series have had their games collected. It started with the Classic series, then went to the X series, and has now arrived at the 6 games of the Zero and ZX series. I'm a huge fan of the Mega Man series, but I've never had the opportunity to play the majority of the Zero and ZX games. I've only played the first Zero game for a little bit, so this new collection will be the perfect way to do that. The Legacy collections always package the games well and add tons of extras like concept art, achievements, challenges, and more. So technically, the game I'm ninth most excited about is more like 6 or 7 games. Either way, the future of Mega Man's world will be back in the limelight this year. If anybody ever questions whether video games can be art, just point them to Hellblade: Senua's Sacrifice. It's got incredible graphics, gameplay, story, presentation, and tackles very serious problems with tact and maturity. I love the first game and how its difficulty ties into its story. Yet it's hard to find a game that succeeds in everything as strongly as Hellblade does. So, once the sequel was announced, I was hyped. There hasn't been much explanation about the story, but the trailer shows some insane visuals, more astounding audio techniques, and it looks like it will be incredible. Man, if Senua's Saga Hellblade 2 is pointing towards what the future of single-player stories are, that just makes me more excited for the future. While video games have advanced as an art medium, sometimes it's good to have games that are just senselessly violent, and that is what the Doom series excels at. The 2016 Doom remake helped streamline the series and has delivered one of the most brutal, but most fun shooting games of the last decade. It is insanely violent, but this perfectly balances extreme violence with the game's tone, so it doesn't really feel out of place. The sequel, Doom Eternal, looks like it's going to deliver more upon the best parts of its predecessor, while also bettering the pacing and some of the slower parts of the game, by making them less that way. Not only was Doom 2016 a great remake, but its strong foundation is allowing for its sequel to make it even better, and I'm just going to wonder how many consoles it will be on, and other devices, like the original Doom. When it comes to the Xbox, it's only really got one truly iconic franchise, that being Halo. Master Chief is an iconic character, and the Halo games always mix great gameplay with a great sci-fi story, generally involving religious zealots. The recent games have been produced by 343 Studios, and while they haven't hit the same heights as some of the Bungie games, they've still delivered a great experience. But Halo Infinite just like looks like it might hit those Bungie heights again. While a cinematic trailer doesn't fully explain a game, Infinite's trailer shows Master Chief being reawoken, which could be a not-so-subtle nod to the series being reawoken and reinvigorated now. On top of that, I think Microsoft is going to go hard with Infinite, as it is the launch title for the Xbox Series X, or Xbox, both of which are just dumb names. As a company, Marvel is as big as they've ever been. While Disney has helped boost them in the movie and TV show departments, we were still lacking many solid non-LEGO Marvel games. At least until this year, that is. The not-at-all-confusingly named Marvel's Avengers looks like a Destiny-style game with an in-depth story that features a bunch of classic Marvel heroes and villains. The promise of multiple different heroes who all have unique gameplay styles is great, and even though some characters don't look as fun, such as Iron Man's style, which looks like an on-rails shooter, the multitude of unique styles looks like it will create a unique superhero game experience, something the Batman Arkham games, while great in that one style, have not been able to expand on. Plus, it's got unlockable characters based on the comics, which instantly hooks me, especially because the basic costumes do look generally like the movie stunt doubles. However, the Taskmaster outfit is way better than the one that we see in the Black Widow trailer. So there's that. I love myself a good 2D platformer, and if it's got a unique style, that just adds to the package. This is exactly why I love the Shantae series, but especially the most recent game, Half-Genie Hero. It changed the series' traditionally retro 16-bit aesthetic to a hand-drawn, animated style. It looks absolutely gorgeous. Not only does the upcoming sequel, Shantae and the Seven Sirens, keep the style, but it's also got an animated intro by the famous Studio Trigger. It helps show the personality from this game, and seeing it before a premiere showing in movie theater was pretty surreal to me. One great thing about the Seven Sirens is that the first part of it was released on Apple Arcade, showing a bunch of gameplay. Judging by this early stage, Seven Sirens has a strong start, and if the rest of the game continues that momentum, that just might be the best Shantae game yet. One of the first video games I ever played was the first LEGO Star Wars game on the PlayStation 2, and I loved it. The LEGO series continued from that game and expanded to tons of different franchises, from Harry Potter to Pirates of the Caribbean, as well as previously mentioned Marvel games, with almost yearly releases, even today. But this year, we're getting a return to some of the earliest, and in my opinion, best, LEGO games, LEGO Star Wars. This is coming in the form of LEGO Star Wars: The Skywalker Saga. Not only will it have levels for all of the new movies, Last Jedi and Rise of Skywalker, but it's remaking levels for episodes 1 through 7. Not much video has been shown, but that's probably because it's too good for human eyes right now. Every picture shown off so far, though, just looks beautiful. So while the Mega Man Zero and ZX collection may have 6 old games, this essentially has 7 remakes and 2 new games. Plus, if the original LEGO game can make the prequel trilogy fun, I'm sure they can fix Rise of Skywalker with this one. While it might not be very apparent for my channel, I love horror games. One of my favorite franchises is Resident Evil, which just received a stellar remake of its second game, which was easily my favorite game of 2019. The gameplay, story, presentation, music, graphics, it was all incredible. While I was happy with the results of that and resigned myself to a few more years of waiting until the next game or remake, Capcom decided to bless us with a remake of Resident Evil 3. Everything looks so good, with the graphics looking even better than Resident Evil 2's remake. The atmosphere seems to be insanely tense, and the formerly titular villain Nemesis looks downright terrifying. And that's a feat after seeing him go toe-to-toe against Marvel characters. April can't come soon enough to continue the story of Jill Valentine in Raccoon City. Nintendo is easily my favorite game company, as they've created the majority of my favorite game series. But no other series brings me the same level of peace and contentment than that of Animal Crossing. That is why Animal Crossing New Horizons is the game I'm most excited for in 2020. While this entry looks like it will be a bit different, having to establish the island I'm going to live on, it's just going to open up more gameplay and customization opportunities. The idea of building up the town and island I'll be playing on is going to give a new level of creative freedom found only in spin-offs so far, not yet the main series. Plus, it will give ample time to meet the new villagers once they move in. The Switch was just begging for an Animal Crossing with its strong graphics and portability, so New Horizons will be perfect for travel and at home. Animal Crossing has always been a calming series for me, and this next entry seems like it will improve on the best parts of New Leaf, which is something that will be definitely great in 2020. However, paying Tom Nookback is gonna suck. I just bought an island from him. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed my video, please leave a like, and comment down below what games you're most excited for in 2020, or if you think any of my opinions are incorrect. Let me know what I can do better down there as well. And subscribe if you'd like to see more videos like this. I'm going to try to start using the channel more in 2020. So until next time, goodbye.